Good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. I'm Ted Curran. I manage the finances and business operations for the Tepper School of Business at Carnegie Mellon. And I guess my session, it was an idea of some folks from Tableau. I had presented like 2 years ago, and I guess there was a feeling that sometimes you see something cool or you hear these plans, and there's no real kind of follow-up, like to say, well, did they do what they said they were going to do? And so the focus today is on reporting consistency and creating ROI in higher education and with company partners. And I'm not here to let myself speak. So if you want to see something, I will do it on the fly. I have examples. Of course, you test the network, and it works just fine yesterday. But now we're hoping, which is obviously critical, that I can easily access all of the dashboards and things. Because I want to show you things that are private, and I also want to show you things that are public. Am I going to get to go to my next slide? Does it work? Ah, it works.
Are you sure it works? Before you walk away, are you sure it works? Are we sure it works? So, hoping and praying it all works. Auto position. So,
reporting consistency across divisions. I don't know about you, but I mean, whether it's in the business school or kind of across the university, this is a really challenge. And we went the direction of growing organically with a handful of schools and kind of growing that way, as opposed to kind of top down from a centralization. I'm not saying one's better or worse. I just knew in our environment, I would have waited like years to get through the whole process. Now, of course, we did all the information security and all those kinds of things. And really moving from just reporting to trends. How many of you are using any sort of predictive in your solutions? So it's a relatively small group, and they all seem to be bunched. So so one of the nice things is we've dropped stuff out into MATLAB and these other things, but you can integrate R into Tableau. Do y'all know that? I think the biggest challenge we have is when you do these things is not jumping to conclusions, especially when it's not significantly statistically significant. I know there's a number of times where you look at this stuff and it looks a little bit random. But tracking, this is kind of my bread and butter, which is really, as a finance person, is returns. As we get at universities, we get away from so-and-so runs to the dean and says, I want this, and maybe we have corporate partners here, so put it in your vice president or whatever these kinds of things are. But really, you know, I've been charged with, you know, a data-driven approach to deciding, well, what is it we're going to invest in? And both financial and non-financial, right? I mean, the financial is relatively easy. You can teach an MBA or whatever. You can discount cash flows and say, okay, the project, you know, it's going to cost me this. There's returns, and then you go from there. But let's face it, so many of us have returns for a lot of non-financial things. You know, student satisfaction. What's it worth to go up in the rankings? And so what I've tried to do is put a dollar to these things. If it's worth $2 million for the Tepper School to go from 11th in the world to 9th, well, maybe we're willing to invest $1 million and get a 50% return. Does that make sense? And of course, you have to track against it and make sure you're accountable at different steps so it doesn't just become a sunk cost. So I got some methodologies. I've got some forms. Maybe I can share them with you afterwards. I've got business cards on the back table. You have so many sessions, and I guess I'm the first one before lunch. So my goal is for you to come away with 3 to 5 takeaways. You say, wow, I learned something. And if you didn't, you can throw things at me or email me for what you needed. Okay? So the Tepper School, we're kind of the Kwani school, you know, management science, computer science. The business school is very technical, very little cases, very few Harvard cases. It's very, you know, if you're not technical, it's probably not the place for you. And that makes it even harder for me. I was an alum and came back, and I found that my analysis had to be uber tighter than it ever was in industry, because I was doing it for, you know, Nobel Prize winners and SEC economists. So they really picked through my analyses and justifications. And obviously we have a benefactor in David Tepper, who has been the top hedge fund manager in like 3 years. And so he's invested a lot of money in the school, and he wants results, and he wants to see data for his investment. Big surprise, right? Tableau thought I should just give you a little background about Carnegie Mellon and maybe some of the technologies you all use. We've spun out a whole slew of technologies. We have an open learning initiative, Panopto. Do any of y'all use Panopto? That's one of our companies that is in a spinoff thing. ReCAPTCHA, Louis Vanon is on our faculty. Those words that you can't read that bang your head against the wall, so you keep typing until to get away from all the the crawlers that are going to websites. And so I just wanted you to get a basics. And so for me, Tableau is what ties this stuff together. The root cause or problem, whether it's reporting or ROI, has been this uniqueness of the institution and the needs of integrating the stuff for the institution versus the student. I mean, most of our networks are wide open. These kids can download wherever the heck they want, and they do. I've seen the logs. But let's face it, we all have FERPA compliance and all kinds of other things where we have to keep that data uber secure. So I feel like often with students, I'm looking for ways to integrate all these things that they're doing, whether it's integrity checking, note-taking, their podcasts, bringing these things together so that their learning can come together, which is very different from the systems we're doing. We have 18 systems integrated into Tableau. 18. So some of them you probably are using yourself. So we bring in Oracle data. Do any of you use Apply Yourself, Hobson's? Any of y'all? Nods, vigorous nods. We bring in Simplicity for the Career Center. We bring in alumni relations data from iModules. We bring in financial aid data from, what's that thing called? Yes, thank you. We bring them all, advanced module. We bring all these things because nobody wants to get a report from 18 different areas. They just want to go to one place and be able to see across the business. And that was one of the root items and goals with this project. I also wanted to introduce Jill Wooster. She's an information and business analyst, and she's a heck of a lot smarter than me when it comes to building dashboards. I'm one of the people that has to consume this stuff. So I'm kind of doing it from that perspective of how I use these on a day-to-day basis and how I've tried to influence people on the power of Tableau. But Jill's fantastic. I know, is Jen Underwood here? No, Jen's worked with us, and there's a number of folks from InnerWorks that have worked with us, like Eric Sharla, who spent a lot of time in higher education. He's here in the back. Maybe you can raise your hand, Eric. He brings an interesting perspective, too, because he's done it not only with universities, but also with things like the ACT and these other kind of things. So, to me, it's so critical. I mean, the question I get, it's borderline irritating. Every time they get something, they'll say, is it right? Or are they just telling me what they think I want to hear, so I'll say yes, right? Is the gift number that the fundraisers gave me right, or are they throwing in foundation grants and all that other kinds of stuff? So my goal with Tableau is constantly to say, hey, look, I'm not arguing balls and strikes, but I want you to make sure it's consistent across the board. These are gifts. If you want to include fundraising as gifts, you include that in, but you can't count it both ways, right? You can't count it as sponsored research and as gifts, and really being able to go quickly and easily between calendar year, reporting year, and fiscal year, or even government academic calendar year, and making it simple. I mean, one of the things we've built is tables, so you can write Q1, 1Q, JUL to SEP. Right, August. So, yeah, and so some of my things aren't going to be like global best practices. They're like global survival practices. So one of the things, assuming the network works, I'm going to show you a Dropbox where we just can't automate it. So we have a place where you can securely enter the data. It's one way to do it, right? The goal is to automate, but sometimes you got to survive. So I recommend having a secure Dropbox for those things that you enter maybe once, twice a year, or maybe on a fairly sporadic basis. And I have a trick for you. How do you get out of the business of nagging the manure out of everybody to get their data updated? You publish a dashboard so that the deans can see it or your leaders can see it and shows last updated. There's nothing better than them having to explain to them, and then you stay out of it. It was the greatest tool. I encourage you all to do it. Have a pretty little red, yellow, green, or something that, like, you know, flies around that says so-and-so didn't keep their crap updated. You can edit that for the tape. Apparently, we're being taped. Seriously, that's a takeaway. Do it. Build a dashboard that shows how often people are keeping it updated. Or at least it'll help when you have automated feeds. We're getting data right now for Google Analytics constantly. I want to know if it bombs out. Because I want to make adjustments when we're spending big money based on the data in the morning. Maybe we need to make adjustments for the afternoon. I want to know if something's crashing. You need a dashboard that shows how often the data's been updated. And some kind of, you know, you can have a more technical one for you guys, but so that, like, management kind of, like, you know, big puffy letters that shows, like, updated, you know, not updated. And then they can deal with them rather than us constantly hounding those people. Does that make sense to everybody? Is this useful? You want to stop and answer questions? You want me just to fly into the software and pray to God it works? It worked yesterday. Let's see. So I want to show you some of these things. Oh, come on. Is there somebody here from the thing that can just ensure I get on the network? Pretty please. Pretty please. All right, all right, all right. We're in business. All I have, I can go to anything. If you say, Ted, I want to see how you do GIFs, I'll show you my GIFs and how you can quickly and easily in seconds see them. But I wanted you to see these things because I'm going to show a slew of dashboards. So one of the easiest ones, one of the most basic ones that was driving people nuts was how many of you, your faculty, how many of your deans know your faculty and staff numbers? Do they know it right on the spot? How small? Okay, but my argument is, and tell me if I'm wrong, is as the first thing out of my mouth is, so what do you mean by faculty? Are you including tenured stream? Are you including adjuncts? Are you including teaching track? So I wanted to make the world uber simple so that at all times they could see the information and he could click. I pray this thing is working. Why is this thing not working? But I wanted to make it incredibly simple so he could quickly go and see his economists or see his marketing faculty, and he could pick tenured stream, who's got tenure, who doesn't have tenure, who's an adjunct, who's a visitor, quickly and easily. And the most important thing, help network person, is to be able to see it over time, right? He wants to see, well, how do these things trend over time? Because we have specific goals to increase our faculty counts in some areas and decrease them in others. And to me, Tableau is the tool to be able to show that effectively. This is super frustrating. I'll come back. And so moving beyond, I'm going to come back. I have to show you this stuff. I have to. Which is, you know, beyond reporting and kind of historical to proactive. I mean, you can have just kind of basic trend lines, right? You can just kind of fit points. But what we're trying to do is, what are some ways that you can use statistical analysis to make your business easier? For me, one of them is tuition. I mean, these guys would give me their tuition, their things, and I think 20 years ago it was easy. You would just take, like, students times the price. You throw the numbers in, but now we have so many different programs, right? You have part-time, flex-time, executive MBA, you know, things run across summers, the new tuition price starts in September, and so those things are critical to getting it right. And then what I also found was that people would forget that, like, things happen, like people take leaves, or, you know, busy executives might have to, like, not be able to take their next two classes because they're shipped off to to Dubai. And so what I tried to do is say is, well, let me get a factor. So whatever they give me, I adjust by that so I can give really good forecasts. Now, I'm a finance guy, right? So that matters to me. But how else would you guys use it? Come on, somebody. I just might cry. How else would you use? How else is there? Do you have any examples of how you would use them? This is supposed to be interactive, which is hard with this setup. Okay. But I mean, for him, he can just click back and forth. He can pick a date. He can click on people, and he can say, "Well, I really just want to look at my economists that are full time," and immediately see them. He can look at it at certain dates. He can do things at staff. It was an eye-opener for us to see that our staffing was very legacy and how few analysts we had, and yet we had executive directors like me. We don't need so many SpongeBob managers, right? We need more people that do things. You know, our administrative coordinators. How do you make those adjustments in those things? And so this is a simple dashboard, but it's a very, in my opinion, it's a very important one. Oh, unexpected error. Thank you, guys. So hopefully this will all work just fine. I'll just cry. Career centers. I don't know about you, but in a business school, your ability to place people is make or break. It is make or break. The ability on the outside is what brings them in. Of course, we don't say we place people. We career opportunity them, or whatever the heck that's called. So constantly having at their fingertips, who are top recruiting companies? What are the offers over time? How many part-time, how many students that are in the internships get there? I bet you all have this. But my experience has been it's all in reports that they throw out of drawers from Simplicity or Ease or whatever these things are. And so that was my goal, is I want to give it to him, and it's simple. And he can, if you saw, he could just click on it. He could see his top 10 recruiters. That was real. Amazon was our top recruiter. He could quickly see that. He could flip between internships or for this master's program versus your traditional MBA program. Are they hiring in the economics area, in the undergraduate areas? We're a little bit different in that undergrad economics is housed within our business school. One of the only ones that do that. So obviously some of our numbers are obviously going to be a little bit different in our makeup as well, because economics is a little bit different from the TA support needs to the size of the classes. Is this useful beyond some of the little problems I'm having? I mean, one of the problems I've had was everybody was like, I need access to everything, but if they need my stuff, it's uber secure, so you got to come through me. That self-service concept, which we're all desperate for, I don't want to ask you, I don't want to send emails, is critical. And I've ran out of creative ways of telling people that this is the future. Figure out a way to do it secure. Am I asking you to be able to look up the social security numbers of every person? Of course not. But there has to be a way to share this data across the board. And it's required a lot of bringing of people together. People asked me, so how did you go about doing this? So I was going to show you, if that's OK. One of the things that I would recommend you all to do is consider having a template, and not a template to waste people's time. It can be Word, it could be whatever y'all want. But the reason I like this is because we started asking questions to understand what it is we report on. But let's not just focus on what you've always done. Focus on what it is you need to make decisions better. And the information that came out of it was amazing. Finding out that units run, they get these 10 to 12 reports and only two of them are useful. And then focusing on, forget what data is easy, because people tend to gravitate to the stuff that's really easy to get, right? Like rankings or, you know, some information that gets spit out of AACSB. Oh yeah, take the pictures. But what are your business issues that you're trying to do? I mean, you know, our alumni relations, this is an example, wanted to be able to search for names of prospectus to be featured in the alumni magazine. He wanted ROI for alumni events. You know, this was very different than the things that we were giving them before Tableau. I'm happy to send y'all, if you want to take my card, a template. It probably won't be perfect for your business, but to get people thinking about what it is you need and really, you know, gives you that starting point. We never just jump into things. People always say, I want dashboards. You have to have a process. My process is, if it's ROI related, establish a baseline, define what it is that you want, figure out the value, and then figure out how you're going to get the data and track against it. And then hold people accountable for what they said. I'm not saying beat them up and throw them out the window if they don't increase student satisfaction by 50%. But don't ask me to invest $500,000 and have the number move nowhere. Is this useful? Tails the finance guy. Why doesn't nobody likes the finance guy? I feel like, so I had a faculty member, and he said, he was Turkish, and he rubs his belly, and he says, Dude, people shouldn't hate you, but they really shouldn't like you. I guess what I'm saying is, you should eat lunch alone a lot. So, yeah. So if it's okay with you, I will walk you through. I do ROI stuff. I have my own spreadsheets where I do human capital management. I calculate, and I'm happy to share them with you. Not the whole thing. That's my secret sauce. But, you know, calculating, well, is if we're trying to recruit the best people, right? Well, do we have metrics on how often, you know, how many candidates are coming from internally or from campus, from externally? How many promotions are we doing? These kinds of things. Putting real data to this stuff rather than just 15 people went to a training session. Nobody cares. They don't. I mean, I've had to gut a ton of training programs where people said it's garbage. You know, I mean, there's certain things you kind of have to do because it's touchy-feely. But beyond that, you know, I only want to do stuff that really matters. I will invest in people nonstop if there's a return. If I can grow them, if I can grow us, if we can help retain some of our best people. I was going to walk you through a little ROI measuring exercise, if that's cool with you all. So marketing was one that was kind of interesting because sometimes it's not financial. And what I really wanted to do is give them a seat at the table to kind of help justify it. You can imagine business schools, we spend a truckload on marketing. I sometimes like have a heart attack when I see the money going out the door. So the paradigm here is let's view it as an investment. Let's define that baseline, define a goal, what it's worth, and what we're going to spend. And so what if our goal is 50 more qualified applicants, right? You have your gross tuition, your marketing investments, discounts. We can use all kinds of fancy terms like scholarships, offsets. Is there additional staffing? I always want to include the additional cost. Don't just tell me I want 50 more people. If it's going to require more resources in other areas, I want to at least think it through. Does it have to be perfect? No. But think it through. Don't end up adding like mad collateral cost damage, like computing costs that you haven't at least factored for. What's your net revenue and your ROI? And so, and one of the things that we've really focused on is I hate these ROI exercises or reporting exercises that are one-time things. I don't want you doing things that are going to help me raise a class 1 year for 50 people. I want you to be able to put things in place that are sustainable for the long term. I mean, I see some of the schools, I see Michigan, I don't have a hard time getting applicants. I have a hard time getting the right applicants. So how do we do this for the long term and make adjustments rather than just doing the same stuff and saying, hey, I added 50 last year, and making those adjustments so that it's sustainable? No. We'll make it. But measuring ROI. And so what I wanted to get them to is, well, so what are we focusing on, guys? And in marketing, they're looking at brand attributes, satisfaction, loyalty, trust, number of people who apply, attend during campaign. Many marketing groups have a huge impact on these things. This is all stuff we can capture. My guess is it's kind of scattered right now in spreadsheets amongst various peeps. Referrals, job placement, new partnerships, companies. Let's recognize how these tangible things. I'm constantly saying, let's capture this stuff. You know, let's capture and highlight the heck out of alumni who refer awesome candidates to our programs or who bring in companies and recruit. That's worth a gift to me. That's worth a $20,000 gift. That's worth, pick a number. That's worth it. We should be highlighting those things too. Now and later revenues. Does this make sense to you? My goal is to capture stuff that matters. It's all in Tableau. I bring it all in. It's all in the Tableau. Surveys. brand awareness. Yeah, we bring in, what's the Gannett thing called? One of these marketing, what's the service that marketing uses? No. We use Simply Measured, but then Gannett has one of these things that has a needle that shows brand awareness. So we start sucking it in and then seeing, well, as we do these things, does our brand awareness with these target groups go up? It's often helpful to have a target. You know, if you're focusing in a certain industry, I'll be honest with you. We wanted to do more in oil and gas. We're in Pittsburgh. The Marcellus Shale is booming. We wanted to do more there. We're not going to be UT Austin. They're awesome. God bless them. They have that huge region of great companies. But we wanted to focus there. So the whole point was, what's our brand awareness with those companies? And then I want to focus on what it is later. My goal, my dream, my one of my nuggets I'm hoping you take away today is I'm turning dashboards and this and analytics and turning it on its head. And I got permission from one student to do this. I believe the future, and I'm going to make my millions, in you know, so often students with cost of education are trying to figure out, should I do this? Why am I making this investment? And my argument is, we should help them create their own ROI. We should understand, okay, I'm a military person, I want to go into finance. So what does that mean? Well, you're probably going to have to take certain classes. You're probably going to want to network with certain people, right? You're probably going to get industry experience in certain areas, right? Let's give them a dashboard so they can track their own progress. And then they can see, you know, I said I was going to network with 10 to 15 people, but I've only met with 3. Maybe I need to make this a focus. And hopefully they'll add things that he'd even think of and say, wow, you know, Carnegie Mellon, the Tepper School, really did this. So here's one student. She started talking about, she created her own little rubric of the things that really mattered to her. And then what I thought was cool was she started kind of defining the skills and what areas she had. And then, and I dummied this out because I didn't want to share too much personal stuff. She started saying, well, of these skills, how am I doing and where am I getting them from? And then the next piece was where do I need to improve even more? So this was a student that worked at Korean University, worked at a National Assembly Research. She was an HR intern in the Tepper School of Business. And what she realized was that some of the areas, that, for example, she said, gee, I realized that outside of Korean University of taking a small project, I haven't gotten the leadership or management skills I've been looking for. I need to now, I have 2 years left in my undergraduate degree, I need to focus on those. I've got problem solving and analytics out the wazoo. Does that make sense? Letting them focus it. The other interesting part was this. We've had a number of folks say, my gosh, by doing this example, what I'm realizing is I'm just going with whatever's in front of me. So I got a job at Merck, so now I'm going pharmaceuticals and Leah. And then some of them are saying, wait a minute, what do I really want to do? Oh, I want to leverage those skills so I can go for a PhD. Or I want to leverage those skills so I can go into a sales finance role. And so to me, that's critical. One of the best parts or coolest parts with Tableau to me is the ability when you start getting more advanced learning management systems that can spit out data. Do any of y'all know Canvas? Ruby on Rails. I love Ruby. But we're a traditional Blackboard shop, but for many of our kind of newer integrated programs, we're using Canvas. And the reason is because we get so much more data and can make adjustments. I mean, there's nothing worse than all one size fits all, right? Okay, well, everybody gets the same amount for TAs. But my guess is that some students need more TAs in some areas versus others. I didn't need a TA for accounting. In fact, I didn't even need to show up. I could just take the tests. But I sure as heck needed it in decision modeling and other things because I came from a finance background. And so what we're trying to do is start making adjustments to our resources from the data in Tableau so that we put the right resource. We all want diverse classes, right? We all want to help. So let's put the people to the things that matters. This faculty member, he did a student level where he started creating a rubric from entry level to developing to accomplished to exemplary. What I thought was interesting, he wanted to start seeing what sites students were going to, and I laughed at what they were, like Khan Academy, Google Charts. So this is where do they go right from the class? You know, go to Wikipedia to look it up. This is real stuff. Then he said, Ted, I don't want to know any of these individuals, but I want to know what industries they came in from. So that data was easy. It was already in the database. We tied it. And so he could see a grade distribution. And you would never want to do it on one thing. But I would never want to say, oh, biotech and internet students that came from there. They're the best. But for this particular class, those students scored really well, and some of the folks from service and consulting didn't do as well. So his comment was, well, maybe I need to provide people from certain backgrounds with a better framework up front, right? That's my point, but you don't know that until you have the data. He took a word cloud from his TA on what they were asking on the site. Incredibly interesting. To actually have data to say, what is it these people are asking? Are they getting it? They wanted to understand ROI and technologies. Does anybody know what heteroscedasticity is? Apparently that was a big one. But you know, Monte Carlo simulation, how can finance better support IT projects? Managing consultants and contractors. You know, these are big business items. And he's made adjustments to his class based on this kinds of stuff to say, I'm gonna hit this stuff. I'm gonna talk about managing consultants versus contractors versus internal employees, temps and other things. I'm gonna focus on those strategies. I don't think he would have done that if he didn't start having the data and start looking and saying, wow, they're asking a lot of these things. Or even things like sharing the course's big picture. Sometimes you have really technical people and they jump right on into it, but they never really take a step back and say, well, here's how it kind of goes larger. So this is just an example. All in Tableau, directly integrated from Canvas. There's like 180 APIs from Canvas. It's wonderful as far as sucking out data. Is this useful? Yeah, hand raise. We've been creating them for him. He just wants to start seeing the data. And so he just keeps spitting them out so that he can make adjustments from there. We're not. So I should give you a little background. So at the business school, we have about 65 users, and we have like 4 people creating dashboards. I'm not saying that's best practices. But if you were here last year, one of the coolest things with Tableau 8.1 or 8.2 or whatever it was that ability to edit from server on the fly. So we have a ton of people doing that, and then they just don't save them. So they make adjustments, and they don't save them. They go to people like Jill to create them from scratch. That's been our model. We've just found that people all say they want to create dashboards, but you know, getting into parameters and all those kinds of things, or they create, you know, junky ones that don't run really well that we have to end up fixing anyway. We just found like we want to give them consuming the data as opposed to becoming experts in dashboard creation. Does that make sense? So we have 60 some users, we have 4 desktop licenses. It's all on server. And we VM that too. So if anyone has techie questions, oh, by the way, I run the Pittsburgh Tug with Jill, the two of us. So we have a great, we've only been like a year, and we've had like 120 people coming out. But these are the things we focus on. Like, how do you VM effectively across, you know, servers? How do you, we have a number of kind of statistical tools. We had Dan Murray to come out and do Tableau Your Data. We had a number of folks that focused on using the shibboleth and going from application to application, and how do you pass your security on from your systems to Tableau? These kinds of things. How am I doing? Is this meeting your needs? Exceeding expectations? I want good reviews. But no, but really, like putting numbers to these things, total promotions, total transfers, career path ratios. I'm trying to put data to everything. Top classes. I mean, I could do one where you lasso and start seeing, well, is there a correlation between faculty that give awesome grades and their FCE information? Yes, can I help you?
Yeah, so you're using a wide variety of very disparate data sources. Uh-huh.
Yeah, so I blew this one. So early on, we gave them to the deans and let them loose. What a disaster. You know, they were questioning admissions. They were doing all kinds of stuff, which I guess in some ways was good. But then I feel like people got defensive. Like, they didn't have the scores, but they had this background, and they gave a great interview, and they did service. So sometimes just looking at a few data points, they were jumping to conclusions. They loved it. But what we found was we had to calibrate and need it. And one of the biggest areas we tie this into, maybe I can show it on the fly and show my skills, is the budget process. What a great time to tie in business intelligence, planning, and the budget process. Is it in here, Jill, or do I need to do a quick search for it? No stress. that's my opinion. That's a great time to make sure they have a common understanding as far as what it is they want to see, because the dean, my dean accesses this stuff securely from anywhere. And I do mean anywhere. Let me just go to, bear with me 1 second, because I'm going to do this on the fly to answer my friend's question. So, you know, we have a lot of our groups are defining their entire ask between Tableau and the budget and planning cycle. And that way, they can explain it through the dean. So, and you'll forgive me, it looks beautiful on an iPad. But being able to show, okay, here's your budget for the current year. By the way, this is real stuff. And that, you know, being able to quickly go between marketing channel by tactic and operating unit for operating expenses. And then he started drilling into editorial visibility by priority and being able to click on things and then have them pop up. Or being able to search on all the articles by our 5 strategic priorities. I don't have a problem showing them to you. Here are my strategic priorities. Probably looks lousy on the screen, but enhancing the experience, global awareness. So if the dean wants to see, well, what articles are tied to these things? You're right. We have somebody kind of tagging them to these things, but we're all capturing this information. How many of you get an email every day of information that's relevant to your business or maybe people that are being in the news from your schools? So we're trying to use that information effectively so somebody could say, I remember there was something from Marvin Goodfriend when he was on Capitol Hill. How do I make it simple for somebody to retrieve it rather than going and finding an email from, you know, 2 years ago? But that's my advice, is when you're having those planning and budgeting discussions to have that tie-in then. It makes a lot of sense. One of the things we found, we were looking at the design projects, what we found was they tried, but most of the projects are unplanned. We started laying them out by channel, by year, by direct mail, by these other kinds of things. They were not planned. You know, they had their plan. I don't know about you guys, but I will prepare my fiscal year 16 budget in like February or March. And a lot of things change. So we're trying to say, well, okay, what things can we know better and plan for? And then what things we just need to buffer in where I don't know what admissions is going to need at the master's program or development, but I want to be ready for it. So that's how we're using Tableau for decision making. Yeah, we have a couple of these services where they suck the data out and we create these emails. So they have this thing that automates every day. I'll just show you a real one. Is that all right? So every day we have this automated thing that shoots out a bunch of emails that are relevant to us. So I guess this was an alum who created craft beer. Students, I don't know what the mic's doing here. Students getting insight into life at SCU. So this automated thing is spitting into Tableau, the automated email. I get this every day, and then the goal is to have that in Tableau so we can search and super on it easily. What I would say was the thing that we have to get better at this on is sometimes you get the same article essentially 3 different ways, right? It's in the Chronicle, it's in Wall Street Journal, and other things. And so we've talked about, well, how do we do some cleanup so that you get the perspectives, but maybe we don't need the same thing produced 10 different ways with like light variations. So the automation kind of creates a little bit of garbage. So I would recommend, and we're talking about, how do we clean it up effectively without somebody saying, gee, you're missing these things. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I always tell them that I can do anything. That's why I go in. I go in saying yes, which is a nice surprise, right? Why go in saying, no. I say yes. If you're willing to make the commitment and you're willing to keep it updated and you're willing to work with us on the ETL process, yes, you can have it.
So just on that, have you guys done an ROI analysis on centralizing all this
data
warehouse?
Yeah, so that's a tough question. So we have a lot of data warehouses, but to me, they're not actually data warehouses. You can probably tell I'm pretty technical for a finance guy. Most of our data warehouses are just screen prints, snapshots of the data. You know, you have an Oracle database, we have a financial data warehouse. You have an HR system. For me, this has become my data mart. The SQL server and publishing the Tableau server has become my data mart. Is that ideal? No. Can I change the university overnight? No. But what I found is that other deans on campus get pretty PO'd when they see that my dean can pull up his financials in 2 seconds and click and group, and that stuff is what's driving it. So we're doing a Workday implementation, which is big money, like 8 figures, and that was one of the items, which is when we get this thing in place, we need a data warehouse that truly integrates these things, not just a screen print of the human capital system versus the HR system versus the student information system. Because if they don't do it, I'm just going to keep integrating them, which is fine, but I'd rather them do it for me at a macro level. The university goal or strategy, because we have 5 different parts of Carnegie Mellon doing it, and now Central is doing the implementation, is to say, hey, we're partners. Anything that's campus-wide, like Oracle and other things, keep it central with a secure pipe to us. And then the Tepper School-specific things, we'll keep on our own servers. That's our strategy. That's our plan. Is it a good one? You adjust it? Help? Is the speaker supposed to ask for help, please? I thought I heard somebody kind of whispering back there. I'm going to go in a whisper. The horse's whisper, is that what that was called? I'd show you the Dropbox for the stuff we can't automate. I can show you the Google Analytics, too, if you want to see them. I can show you anything. So, control click. We are really using public premium for our reporting and our ROI types of stuff. And the feedback from recruiters has been amazing. First of all, they love it that the techie school is giving them the data that they want. But Tableau is driving our analytics for this stuff. You know, I feel like we have these fancy books that show how many people are hiring in these different industries. That's a pile of garbage. Nobody wants it in that format. They want it in a format so they can easily see who's recruiting and bounce it up against these things. So we've used Tableau public premium. Fantastic product. We, on our website, you want to look at our employment statistics? You want to? I love these fancy pictures. I always hope they're students and not like models of whatever. I'm just going to pick an area if you don't mind. I'm doing this on the fly. But you know, they can see finance offers, mean, median, mode, low, high. Here are recruiting partners in the past year. We follow all the MBA COC statistics. So when that thing gets finalized in September, October, that update will be here. And they can see the trends over each year. They love this. I'm winning on this one. No, seriously. I know we have Cisco here and other ones. The recruiter from Cisco is like, I've been asking for this for years. Carnegie Mellon makes it easy for me to know what these things are. And I can see the other companies that are recruiting this year for internships, for full-time, for part-time, for these other areas, and we just follow the MBA COC standards. Does that make sense? Oh, shibboleth. We must have to do a VPN special. I really wanted to show you the Dropbox. Is that okay? It's simple. You take your template, you stick your data in, you upload it. Or in some cases, you enter a few fields. Why don't I do endowment? Endowment values, very important, at least for a business school. Live or die on them. For me, most of my endowment stuff's coming from Oracle, but like Bank of New York Mellon, or you know that information where it's not operating dollars, it's a mix of gifts to endowment, market returns, maybe some gains or losses on Jane, wealthy person, sent in shares. They were valued at that second at $15,500, but when we sold them, there was a loss between the point of getting them and then selling them. So hopefully this will work. How have I done on managing the technical issues? How about a C? A C for Ted? We have very little grade inflation at Carnegie Mellon. So I can do it here. I really wanted to show it to you because for me, everyone always says we have to automate everything. Fine, but there's times where you just, you know, like rankings or something, just let them, give them something simple so they can keep it updated. That's my goal. That is my goal, is to have it, always have a solution to keep the data updated. Whether it's automation, whether it's a template, whether it's a Dropbox. And we have these templates where you say, I'm uploading this data. And then you can click, like, are you blowing away the year or are you just appending to it? It makes it really nice. How much time do I have? 12 minutes. How are we doing? You like this? Am I delivering on value? I'm going to get a high score, and Tableau is going to say, come on back again, Ted. You're the most dynamic finance guy I've ever met. We've tried to make this like kind of like idiot-proof, like, oh, I'm doing endowment, or I'm entering information, so Tableau data editor. They can click a template, download it, upload the information, and then you can see if it's checked. Pull down. Oh, okay. I should know that. It's obvious I don't actually do this. Other people do it for me. And look at this. I can make adjustments right here on the fly, and I can update the endowment, which is really nice. You can just enter the information in. Or I could enter a sheet in, or, you know, whatever you want to do. I mean, is it ideal? No, but I just think sometimes you have to be creative. So we've created this just little Dropbox where people just download little templates, and you just either can put the data in the same columns every time, or if they need to make adjustments, we do. Yeah. That's their responsibility. So if anything, numbers-wise, I check it, or one of my peeps checks it. I mean, we tie out the financials every month. There's no way I'm going to let my dean flip through numbers that don't tie. We have a report that says, do these things match? If the answer is no, I kill the dashboard. I'd rather kill it and have people say something's down than have them work with garbage. That's my opinion. Yeah. So you asked the question. So let's give me an example. I'll do one on the fly. Okay. Let's do the whole project right now in 4 minutes. Yeah, I can imagine customer satisfaction is really important. What are our goals in customer satisfaction? Yeah. Well, you can do that, but do we have a sense of what our current customer satisfaction is? Okay, so 3, but what's it based on? Is it based on, do we have certain data that, what things are you going to track on customer satisfaction or student satisfaction or company satisfaction? So I dig into those things and say, we want companies rating as high on the Career Center stuff. We want companies, when they get certain surveys, to rank as high. We want companies to be giving money to sponsored research. So I keep asking questions till I get down to something that I can put my arms around. Even if they don't know how to get the information, I'll figure that part out. So my goal is, okay, you, part of your customer satisfaction is surveys and the number of times they come back to campus. You decide that's what really matters to you. And the goal is to improve that by 50%. So then I got to capture that information, the current, the baseline, figure out a way to capture it, figure out what the goal is, and then say, okay, well, based on that, what's the return if we get to your goal? Is it a realistic goal? You know, if somebody's saying, well, I'm going to have 100% customer satisfaction, my answer is that's garbage. There's no chance. I'm not investing in that. But the goal is, and the dean agrees, we agree that the goal here is to move from here to here. Then I ask, so what's it worth? And how much are we willing to invest? Remember, these aren't perfect things. If it's worth 100 grand, I don't want to invest 100. That's a net loser. It's just a break even. You know, maybe I'll invest 50 to get up 100 so I can get a 50% return. That's what I do. Does it make sense? I do it for everything. My goal is to quantify stuff that people throw out there, which sounds like crap to me, honestly. You know, oh, we want to increase alumni engagement. So what does that mean? What does that mean? You know, and let's capture those metrics, establish a baseline, set a goal, and make an investment. Yes. I try to count the beans and not tell them. I can give them advice, but a lot of times they'll tell me. I mean, the board of directors, my board, has made it crystal clear. We're 11th in the world right now. They've made it crystal clear what it's worth for them to go into the top 10. They have given me very clear direction on what they're willing to spend to make it happen. You don't. You have to define it, or else I'm not going to invest it in it. If we have a brand awareness problem, then I have to say I'm at here, and I have to decide, well, what am I willing to invest to get from here to here? I don't argue with people if they say brand awareness is worth 100 grand to get to this level, and the dean says it's worth 50. I just need them to come up with something and then decide, well, what are we willing to spend and do to get there? I don't argue with people. They can argue all day. What's the value of having, so here's a real life example. We want to get 10 more junior faculty publishing in elite journals, right? And we all know those elite journals, the A journals, all that kind of stuff for your industry. So my questions were, I'm not going to tell the faculty what it's worth, but I'm going to find out how important it is. And they were making investments and we're making adjustments. So one of the areas, I'll tell you right now, we made adjustments. We gave summer support for the people with the most promise to get them to focus there. So I know the dollars I'm investing, and then afterwards, within a year, I'll know if they achieve their goal. And that will impact future investments. People that are crushing it will get more money. People that say they're going to do it and don't do it won't get more money. So hands-on example of Tableau, data, and goals. Well, I wanted to leave time for questions. I can show you more dashboards from, you know, active alumni, so you can see, well, where are your alums? If the dean's on the road, he wants to see, well, where do people work? Maybe he has a quick hour. Really fantastic opportunities, but you only can do it in chunks, right? If you do it all in one time, it's overwhelming. I mean, Jill and I have been killing ourselves for 2-3 years and just taking piece by piece, but you got to finish them. You don't want to have 50 projects that are at 60%. There's a tendency with business intelligence to have it all non-production ready but kind of looks cool. And then you realize it's not updated and it's not production ready. Yeah? Tons. I mean, Google Analytics was a great example. I mean, we constantly make adjustments based on what's driving traffic. We have a new program, and we're trying to spend our dollars wisely. And what we're finding is some of the money we're just spending, and it's not creating traction, whereas other investments have been fantastic. We're making adjustments based on that data. Because I only have finite resources. My guess is so do y'all. Yeah. I sure do. I have a whole example, but it'll take a little bit more time. If we can meet offline, I'll show you the metrics. I did it on the fly. They invited me to some sort of alumni palooza, and I helped like 5 or 6 schools kind of create their own individualized alumni engagement so they could go back to their area and say, hey, I want to track this, 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 and this. This to me is really important. We need to make these investments. But I'll tell you what some of the basics were with the schools I worked with. They wanted to capture unique attendees to specific events, to events. They wanted to also capture just pure attendees, which was kind of easy, but unique attendees, because what they were concerned about was that it's the same people that come to everything. You know, they come for the free cheeseburger, whatever it is. And then they wanted to see, well, what are we doing with certain key people to get them engaged? So we have a subset. The other ones, I mentioned a little bit of these, alumni engagement. You know, alums that are active in each chapter, how frequent are they active? How many of our leads are coming through alumni? How many alumni are giving money? How many alumni are recruiting or recommending people to recruit? How can we highlight them? How many of them are we highlighting? obviously David Tepper's going to have an article on the Tepper School website every month. But what about like guys like myself who might be doing good things? We've made adjustments through our alumni engagement strategy to say we want to highlight everybody. We want to highlight the people that help recruit. Does that help? I've got like six more areas, but I've tailored each one of them to the specific school. They wanted to make more inroads with undergrads, so they felt like they were connected to the Tepper School. So we laid out a plan for what that made sense for. Does this help? I hope this was useful. I'm here for you. My business card's on the back wall. I would love to meet more of you. I have like takeaways to kind of think about. These are the things that go through my heads. Access data to transform your business, looking at a fresh look at this stuff, strategies to get that cooperation, that buy-in, who are the right people, how do you influence them, selling to management effectively, and ensuring it's not a short-lived initiative. That's one of the biggest fears, problems we have in higher ed. Everybody's doing this stuff, but I'm sure you have a million dead BI projects in your campus. Appreciate your time. I hope this was good.